Hello, my name is Regret. I'm pretty sure we have met every single day of your life. I'm the best friend side that won't let you forget. Hello, my name is D. And these are the lies, and I have believed them for the very last time.
Hello, my name is Shower. One true king, I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace, so that's me. Hello, my name is Shower.
I am no longer defined by all the wreckage behind. One who makes all things new has proven it's true. So take a look at my life.
Hello, my name is Child of the One True King. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace. Hello, my name is Child of the One True King.
Amen. I want to welcome you to the Lansdowne Worship Center tonight. It's good to have you in the house tonight. Would you just raise your hand just like that? You've all been transferred to Lansdowne. We'll expect you here next Sunday morning with your tithe check. Amen. You know, I did that one night when I was pastored in Owings Mills, and we had the Rockville Church in that I had pastored for 10 years, and I was so thinking about those people from Rockville that I said, you've all been transferred to Rockville. And Jeff Robinson just shouted and said, good, we'll take them all. Amen. It is good to have you tonight. I try and say a few things just to make you smile in the beginning. It's good to see old friends. And Dustin's babysitters are here tonight. When he was just a little boy, his babysitters are here. That's okay. You deserve that one. After church this morning, He was in the back of the building, and a gentleman that doesn't come every Sunday came up to him and said, "Pastor, that was a really great message you preached today. Really enjoyed it." And he said, "Thank you." You really didn't think that you were going to get by with that, did you? Amen. I know we look alike, but, you know, there is a limit. I wore this pink shirt by faith this evening that it's spring and not winter. I mean, somebody's got to do something. I know tomorrow's opening day, but even that's not good enough. We're going to have to do everything we can. But I just want to tell you again, it's good to have you. This is our YWEA rally, and folks from all over the district are here. We're so glad that you're here tonight, and we're just going to believe God to touch us in a special way. We have a special speaker who's from the East Baltimore Church of God, Aubrey Roach, and she's right down front here. Good to have her this evening. Good to have each of you. Would you just remain standing as one of our young men, T.J. Greenfield, comes? He's going to be reading scripture.
All right, my scripture is from Isaiah 64:4, and it says, "For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard, nor perceived by the ear, neither has the eye seen, O God, besides you, what he has prepared for him that waits for him." And pretty much what that means is whatever promises God has promised you, you have no idea what's in store for you.
I'll tell you how old I am. I said, "T.J. Greenfield's coming to read scripture," and I didn't see a Bible. And I thought, "Son," I thought, "well, then he's going to quote it." And he clicks it up on his phone. That's how out of touch I am. Another young man, Hunter Stump's coming to lead us in prayer. Then we'll go right back into worship.
Praise the Lord. I was actually very surprised how many people actually made it out tonight with the rain and the snow and everything like that. Now, we need some more people on this side. I think some of you guys are going to have to shift just a little bit over. It just looks kind of weird. This side is almost completely empty. But I guess I'll just go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll just continue on with worship and just get on with the service. Everybody want to bow your heads? Lord, we just thank you for this day, God. Even with the rain and the snow and the things coming between, Lord, you are still the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, Lord. God, we just thank you, Lord, that we just get to be in your presence tonight, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, that for everything that you do, Lord. And God, we just ask you, Lord God, that as your word comes forth tonight, Lord, and as the songs go on, God, that it would just pierce our hearts, Lord Jesus. God, we just ask you, Lord, that you be with us, Lord, in this day, in this time. In your name I pray. Amen.
Yeah.
peasant row. Order out my future days to come. Your presence is heaven to me. Your presence is heaven to me. Your presence. Days on earth I will away. The moment that I see you face to face. For nothing in this world will satisfy. Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry. Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry. Your presence, Lord, your presence is heaven to me.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Go to that third verse again. Go to that third verse again.
All my days on earth I will wait. The moment that I see you face to face. For money in this world will satisfy. Jesus, you're the cup that won't run dry. Your presence, your presence is heaven.
And keep my eyes above the waves.
Quickly for the home folks right here at Lansdowne, those members of the Church and Pastors Council, we have a follow-up meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. I promise you it should not be long, but we have someone coming in to talk to us about that lighting situation in the FLC, so if you'll be here at 7 o'clock, and guys, let's meet in the FLC if we can. That'll help us visualize even what they're talking about tomorrow night at 7. We're about to receive our evening offering. It will go for the YWEA project this year in Africa. But before our young people come, I just want them to be ready. We have a little video clip that we're going to show, and I'm going to ask them to show that right now. building a firewall in Africa this year. And God's going to bless our efforts. I want to thank you for being here. I know from all over the district. Could every pastor stand? If you're a pastor right now, would you stand, please? We want to recognize our senior pastors. Would you give these men, associate pastors, youth pastors, stand as well? Amen. We're glad you're here tonight. Thank you for bringing your people. Amen. Thank you so much for bringing your people. On behalf of our state director, Sean O'Neill, I just want to say thank you. This is a great crowd on a rainy, snowy Sunday night. And for some of you, it was a little bit of a drive. Probably you came through a tunnel or went over a bridge. And I just want to say thank you. Right now, I want our ushers to come. We're going to pray, and they're going to wait upon you. Guys, if you'll come, and gals. When you receive the offering, just take it straight out through those doors. There'll be somebody there to pick it up from you, okay? Father, we thank you tonight. God, you've never failed us. You've never let us down. Lord, I remember as a little boy in Flint, Michigan, doing YWEA projects, some of the very first ones. And I thank you, Lord, that all these years we're still teaching our young people and our youth to give and to raise money for world missions. I pray that you'd bless in this offering. We'll give you the praise for that in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Our speaker tonight is from the East Baltimore Church, Aubrey Roach. I don't know that I'd ever met Aubrey. Maybe I had until just before church time. And I don't know a lot about her, but I know that she is a worshiper because I watched her worship during church tonight. And anybody that is a worshiper, I already have a kindred spirit with. And so I want to just turn this part of the service over to Sister Aubrey Roach. Aubrey, you just do what God tells you to do.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, somebody, get up on your feet and praise the name of the Lord. He is worthy of all glory, of all honor. There is none like him. There is none beside him. Nobody can compare to him. It is just him and him alone. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, make a shout of praise in this place tonight. I said make a shout of praise in this place tonight. For he is worthy, he is worthy, he is worthy. And Father God, I pray tonight, God, that you would come and visit with us. God, that your presence would be so real in this place, God, that we would be overwhelmed in your power and in your spirit. And God, tonight, that you would come and you would ignite the firewalls, God. God, that you would ignite our firewalls, God. God, that you would set us on fire for you. God, that nothing would stop us, nothing would hinder us. And God, that you would have your way tonight. God, I recognize that I am nothing without you. I can't preach without you. I can't sing without you. I can't praise without you. You are the reason why I'm here. You are the reason that you've given me life, God. If it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be here, God. And I praise your name, God, for all that you've done. God, for what you're going to do in this place tonight. God, because I believe that tonight people's lives will be changed. God, the people would be set on fire for you, God, and there will be no stopping them. God, we thank you for everything that you've done, all that you're going to do tonight. And God, I pray tonight that you would have your way. God, that tonight you would have your way in this place, God. God, that you would come visit with us, that you would move up in the altars and in the aisles, God. And God, that you would anoint your word as it's preached. And God, that when I open my mouth, God, that you would fill it. Father God, that you would speak through me, God. I am your vessel. God, you've created me to be used by you, God, and I give myself completely to you because I can't do this without you, Jesus. So God, tonight I pray that you come and you preach this message because I can't preach any single word, God, but if you would just come and preach through me, God, your people would be changed and set free. Oh, God, I pray tonight that you would just come like a mighty, mighty rushing wind, God, and that you would turn this place upside down. I thank you, God, for all that you're doing and all that you're going to do tonight and all that you've set out to do for each and every person here tonight. I pray, God, that you would bless each and every person here tonight. God, that your people's ears would be open to hear from you. And God, that they would receive the words, God, that you've given in my heart. And we thank you and we praise your name. And we ask all these things in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen and amen. It is an honor to be here tonight. When I got the phone call to come and preach here, I literally stopped breathing. I was at work and I was like, and that was it. And I started kind of freaking out. And yes, I go to the East Baltimore Church of God. With my pastor, Pastor Bob. Give it up. Whoop, 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 whoop. Thank you for the Church of God staff that asked me to come. Thank you, Brother Jerry Elder. There you are. I'm sorry. Thank you for the opportunity to come and stand in your pulpit. So the theme of this rally is igniting the firewall. I've prayed and I've prayed and I've prayed about God, what do you want me to say? What are you dealing with me? And so he's given me two scriptures. I'm reading from the New King James, and then I'm also going to read from the Message. Please don't throw stones at me. Thank you. Okay, our first scripture that we're going to be reading from is Matthew 3, verses 11 through 12. It is on the screen. Matthew 3:11-12, the New King James Version says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with an unquenchable fire. The Message Version says it like this, I'm baptizing you here in the river, turning your old life in for a kingdom life. The real action comes next. The main character in this drama, compared to him, I'm a mere stagehand. But he will ignite the kingdom life within you, a fire within you, the Holy Spirit within you, changing you from the inside out. He's going to clean house, make a clean sweep of your lies, and he'll place everything true in its proper place before God. Everything falls, he'll put out with the trash to be burned. The second verses of scripture that the Lord gave me was Luke chapter 12, verses 49 through 51. The New King James Version says it like this. He says, I came to send fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled, but I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how distressed I am until it is accomplished. But do you suppose that I've come to give peace on this earth? I tell you, not at all, but rather division. The Message Version says it like this. I've come to start a fire on this earth. How I wish it were ablazing right now. I've come to change everything, turn everything up right side up, and how I long for it to be finished. Do you think I came to smooth things over and make everything nice? Not so. I've come to disrupt and confront. These are the words that the Holy Spirit have given to me, and I'm telling you tonight, something is going to happen in this place where it's going to trigger. You're going to trigger something inside of you is going to ignite, and you're not going to be able to contain it. Why? Because tonight, we're going to ignite the firewall. There is no doubt in my mind that God is doing a new thing. Whatever is going on in the earthly realm is also going on in the spiritual realm as well. And during these past 7 years, there has been such a dramatic change in what is morally accepted that it's nauseating. Homosexuality has plagued this country more than ever before. Teen pregnancy is a common thing now. It is nothing for a little girl to have two mommies or two daddies. And when going to the doctors for checkups, it's not popular to have a 16-year-old girl come in and not be pregnant. Being a virgin is unheard of nowadays, and when it used to be so common. And while the world rejoices in its sin, there is a church that cries in brokenness and repentance. But sadly, there are also churches that are rejoicing in the world's sin as well. And instead of the world looking like the church has started looking more and more like the world. We've transformed sanctuaries into nightclubs. We've replaced praise and worship with fog machines and strobe lights. And we play what's hot on 106.5 and 92Q in the sanctuary because we want to be able to relate and draw the young people in. Meanwhile, Miley Cyrus is coming in like a wrecking ball, and she's knocking a generation straight into hell. The church has become seeker-friendly. They've compromised preaching truth because they're too worried about offending someone or throwing somebody off or making somebody uncomfortable or losing numbers in the church. But please please understand that there is nothing comfortable about the gospel. The gospel was not written to make you feel good. It was written to bring correction and discipline and conviction to your life. So by no means does this gospel made to make you feel comfortable. Jesus said at the end of verse Luke 12:53, Jesus says, I've come to disrupt and confront. In a poem that I wrote a few years ago, maybe some of you know it, I performed it at Winterfest, but there is a section of the poem that I wrote, and it says, but it seems like we painted this picture of you're an easy, laid-back Jesus, everyone's tight with Jesus, you can still smoke weed and love Jesus, and a little sin is okay, you can still get to heaven, but somewhere along the way, someone forgot to mention who you really are. See, we have painted in our hearts this picture that Jesus is all peace and love and he's all mercy and no judgment. But when we read this, I've come to disrupt and confront. What Jesus is saying is, I'm not coming to play games. I've come to set the facts straight. No longer can you live how you want to live. No longer can you talk how you want to talk. No longer can you walk how you want to walk. No longer can you date how you want to date. No longer can you go to the club on Saturday and party it up and drink like everything's good, and you come to the church on Sunday morning lifting your hands, and the meanwhile you're saying, I'm set free, but in reality you won't even let Jesus get close to you to touch you. And we wonder why the church is dying. It's because too many people want to play games in the church when he's saying you have got to get it right. My God. Hallelujah. 1 Peter 2:9 says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should shew forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. See, when God calls you out, that means there is no going back. And when he calls you out, it's your job to tell the world what he just did for you. It's your job to say, I once was blind, but now I see. I once was deaf, but now I hear. It's your job to minister the gospel of Jesus Christ to every person that you come in contact with. God is calling you, and he has set you apart to be used for his glory. You are chosen. We are to be in the world, but not of the world. We're in it to win it, but not be a part of it. I said we're in it to win it, but not be a part of it. We've got it twisted that we're supposed to be a part of the world. You're not supposed to be part of the world. When he called you, he set you apart to be used for his glory and his glory alone. And if he's called you out, then you're supposed to tell about it. Not be ashamed about it, not hide your light, not contain this fire that he's put inside of you. And these walls that we've built to contain the fire that God is putting on us is preventing us from spreading his glory and his power. And God is yelling to a generation, it's time to ignite the firewall. I said, God is yelling to a generation that it's time to ignite the firewall. So while sin is growing, the church is dying. But God. These could possibly be the best two greatest words that could ever be put in a sentence. But God. Romans 5:20 says, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. There is no doubt that the world is drowning in sin, but where sin is, there is even more grace. And like the song says, if grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. Nobody's perfect. Nobody can come up and say you're whiter than white, perfect as perfect can be, because there is none. But where sin is, there is that much more, if not more, grace. And while there seems to be no hope, God is raising up a remnant of people that are blood-bought, sanctified, Holy Ghost-filled, tongue-talking. There is a generation that God is raising up with faith-shaking, chain-breaking, bold preaching, no compromising anointing. God is raising up a generation that has the Holy Ghost and fire. The theme of the rally is igniting the firewall. And tonight, that's what I've come to do. I've not only come to set our firewalls are ignited, but I've come to set the firewalls around the world on fire. First of all, what is a firewall? When they told me the theme of this message, I was kind of puzzled because I really didn't understand what a firewall was. So I looked up the definition. One was for a computer, so I nixed that out, and I went to the second definition. Firewall is a wall or partition designed to inhibit or prevent the spread of fire. But if we are igniting the firewall, then this fire can no longer be contained. God was never meant to be put in a box. He was never meant to be contained or kept hidden. And I don't know about you, but I'm ready to burn every wall that's kept the fire contained. Why? Because Jesus is coming and people need to hear about this Jesus that sets free, that heals, that delivers, that strengthens, that calls you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. God needs to have his word spread to a generation that is dying. And guess what? They're dying quickly. In Luke 12:49, the very first line of this portion of scripture, Jesus says in the Message version, "I've come to start a fire on earth." He didn't say, "I've come to start a fire just in one particular part of the earth," but the earth. That means all of the earth. And he didn't come to start a fire in just a select people, just like he didn't come to save a certain sect of people. And the Bible says in Galatians 3:28, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." The thing that stuck out to me when I read this is that Jesus says, "I've come to start a fire." So I asked God, I said, "God, why did you come to start it?" And he said, "Because I've called you to finish it." This is why John tells us that we would be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. The Holy Ghost and fire. The Holy Ghost and fire. The Bible says that the same power that raised Christ from the dead is inside of us. The same power that rose Christ from the dead is the same power he used to start the fire. And if the same power that rose Christ from the dead is inside of us, then we have the same power to finish the fire that was sent here to start with. And not only that, but the fire that Jesus sent will be bigger when it's finished, because the Bible tells us that Jesus himself said that greater things we would do. Greater things. That means bigger than what he just did. And I know that's kind of hard to wrap our minds around, because we read about Jesus doing great miracles in the Bible, but he said greater things you would do. And what does the fire represent in the Bible? The fire was used in to one represent his presence. God made himself known to Moses by a burning bush. Exodus 3:2-4 says, "And the angel of the Lord appeared to him, a flame of fire from the midst of the bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with a fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, 'I will now turn aside and see the great sight, why the bush does not burn.' So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called him from the midst of the bush and said, 'Moses, Moses.' And he said, 'Here I am.'" We also read in Exodus 13:21, "And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light. So as they go by day and night." So not only does the fire of God represent his presence, the fire of God will also lead you to where you're supposed to go. The fire of God will keep you in his will. Fire also represents God's punishment in the Bible. In Genesis 19:24, "Then the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of the heavens." And in Revelation 9:17-18, we read about God's judgment being sent to the earth. And fire also represents purification in the Bible. Isaiah 6:6-7, we read about the angel of the Lord coming and touching Isaiah's lips with the burning coal from the altar and taking away his iniquity. And while I was getting this message together, I kept praying, "God, what are you saying? What are you doing? What are you saying? What are you doing in this generation? What do you have planned in this generation, God? What are you doing?" And as I continued to pray, I prayed it over and over and over, and I finally prayed it one last time. I said, "God, what are you doing? What are you saying in this generation?" And he says, "I'm coming to purify a generation." I like how the Message says it in Matthew 3. It says, "I'm baptizing you here in the river, turning your old life in for the kingdom life." The real action comes next. The main character in this drama, "Compared to him, I am a mere strange hand. He will ignite the kingdom life within you, a fire within you, the Holy Spirit within you, changing you from the inside out. He's going to clean house, make a clean sweep of your lives, and he'll place everything true in its proper place before God. And everything false, he'll put out with the trash to be burned." And maybe you're sitting here and you're wondering why in your life your life is going great and wonderful, and then all of a sudden your whole world is being shaken. People that you thought would always be there, always be close, are suddenly gone, and friends that promised to always have your back are no longer there, and you're losing them, and you don't understand why. But in your alone time with God, you're saying, God set me on fire for you. God set me on fire for you. God set me on fire for you. And because you've prayed it, God begins to do it, and he cleans out the house first before he can live there. See, when you want the fire of God, you're going to have to lose some things first. And I know it doesn't always feel good. It's always not comfortable. But if you want to be set on fire for God, you need to make room for his anointing to come in, to captivate you, to consume you. Because if you want the fire, I'm telling you, you have got to lose some things. It's not comfortable and it's not easy, but it is worth it. It's uncomfortable. And in order to grow in him, you have to lose some things. But while you're in the fire, just like the three Hebrew boys, all of a sudden Jesus shows up and you come out unharmed. Everything that the three Hebrew boys had, that they had on them, was thrown into the fire with them. That means every personal possession that they wore was thrown into the fire. Everything that belonged to them was thrown into the fire. But sometimes everything has to be burned first in order for not only you to see Jesus, but so others around you can see Jesus. See, because when they were thrown into the fire, they said, who is that in there? And they said, I know we threw three in there, but I see a fourth, and he looks like the Son of God. And if he throws you in the fire, I'm telling you, he is not going to leave you. He is not going to forsake you. He'll show up all of a sudden, and you'll be in the fire, and you think everything's going wrong, and you think that you've lost everything, and all of a sudden, you look up, and there's Jesus, and you realize that everything is all right. You realize everything is all right. Hallelujah. See, God is coming to ignite the kingdom life that's inside of you, so that what's done in the heavens can be done here on earth. Jesus prayed in Matthew 6:10, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He's coming to set a fire within you. Just like the song says, set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. He wants to set you so on fire from him that you're just like Jeremiah. When Jeremiah said in 29, then I said, I will not make mention of him nor speak any more in his name, but his word was in my heart burning like a fire shut up in my bones, and I was weary of holding it back, and I could not. You're going to get so consumed in the presence of God that you are going to try so hard to contain it, but you'll get more weary trying to hold it in than when you do letting it out. He wants to consume you so much that you're not able to contain it. Jeremiah tried to contain and to keep it in his firewall, but baby, when you get his fire down inside of you, nothing is able to keep it in. Jeremiah was touchable. He allowed God to come and touch him. He knew deep down he didn't want to let it out, but he knew that he had to, so he let God come and touch him to release it. We need to be touchable. Sometimes it's not easy and it's uncomfortable. And physically, we need to touch people to show Jesus to them. There was a time when I was at work. Some of you have seen the story on Facebook, but there was a lady, and she came into my line. I work at Chick-fil-A. Woo-woo, Chick-fil-A. But a lady came into my line, and I could see the tears streaming down her face, and I tried not to pay no mind. I tried not to pay any attention to her. I figured maybe it was allergies at first, but when she got closer, I saw the tears streaming down her face, and she tried really hard not to show it, so I didn't bring it up. I took her order, gave her her drink, and I told her I would bring her food out to her because I knew that this would be an opportunity for me. So she grabbed her drink, and she took down and went and goed and sat down, and she had a little baby with her. So I turned to my manager. I said, "When this lady's food comes up, give it to me." I told her I would take it to her. She said, "Okay." So her food comes up, and I take it, and I go and walk over to her table, and I set it, her food down, and I can still see the tears streaming down her face. And I knew that she was upset, and I couldn't hold it in anymore. And I said, "Are you okay?" And she looked at me, and she said, "No." And right then, she broke. See, too many times we walk by people that are broken, and they need somebody to say, "Are you okay?" Because just like Jesus did with the woman of adultery, when people were calling her and beating her up and, you know, mentally, and Jesus went by and stooped down almost to say, "Hey, are you okay?" See, he got on her level so he could relate to her, because everyone else who was standing looking down on her, when Jesus said, "Hey, I'm right here. I want to relate to you. Are you okay?" So I said to her, "Are you okay?" And she said no, and she broke, and she just wept and sobbed, and I knew she tried so hard not to let it show. So I tried to think, you know, what is the best thing to do, and I started thinking about, you know, what makes me feel better when I'm extremely upset, and I thought about my mom's hugs. I love my mom's hugs. There's nothing like my mom's hugs. My mom's not here right now. She's at work in New Orleans. I miss her, but I know she's listening, I hope. Yes, my mom's listening on the phone. Hi, Mom. I know, I'm sorry. So I said to her, I said, "Are you okay?" She said, "No." So I tried to think about, you know, what made me feel better, and it was my mom's hugs. So I know I look like a complete idiot because I did not know this woman and she did not know me. But I looked at her and I said, "Would you like a hug?" And she looked at me with tears streaming down her eyes and she said, "Yeah, I would really like a hug." So I grabbed her and I gave her the biggest hug ever. And I know that I look completely crazy because I didn't know her. But at that moment, Jesus showed me that to show and share the gospel, it's not just going up to somebody and preaching it, but it's actually physically touching them and showing them the love of Christ. I don't know what she was facing. I don't know what she was going through, but I know for 1 second she got comfort from Jesus that she possibly could have never gotten before. Jesus is calling us to be touchable. He wants us to touch people. We need to be touchable. We need to be available for God to use us, or we're going to miss an opportunity. God wants to set you so on fire for Him so you can't contain it. See, His fire is contagious. It's captivating. It's compelling. You want your churches to grow and your youth group to grow? Put away your fog machines and your strobe lights. Turn off the 106.5 and the 92Q and get in His presence. People don't always care to stop for a light show, and fog doesn't catch their attention, but fire does. Let people hear about people being set on fire for God and watch how many come in. You know, I did some research, and on June 18th, 1995, the day of Father's Day, there was an outpouring of the Holy Spirit at the Brownsville Assembly of God in Pensacola, Florida. This marked the first day of revival. It started in 1995, and it ended in 2000. So this church was in revival for 5 years. And during those 5 years, it was reported that a total 4 million people attended the services. 4 million people attended the services in 5 years. That is a lot of people. 2 years prior to that, the pastor of Brownsville Assembly of God got his church to start praying for revival. People from his congregation got in agreement with him, and some members started to cite prophecies from David Yunji Chow, the pastor of Yoido Full Gospel Church. Just that's in tongues. Thank you, Lord. And his prophecies, it said that the prophecies that David said were inspired by God. And Pastor Cho said that God told him that he was going to send revival to the seaside city of Pensacola, and it will spread like fire until all of America has been consumed by it. When we read, when the revival started, people started hearing about people being saved, healed, delivered. So people would sit in the church parking lot and wait for the church to open its doors so they could rush in. Thousands upon thousands of people gave their hearts to the Lord. And thousands upon thousands of people were filled and got drunk in the Holy Spirit. People came in because they heard that people were being set on fire for God. The revival did not get thousands of people's attention because of fancy lights or smoke machines or the trending music. People came in because they heard testimony after testimony after testimony of, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. They heard how the Baptist boy that used to get drunk every weekend was now getting drunk in the Holy Spirit upon weeks, upon weeks, upon weeks. And they started to hear how the deaf were being healed and how the racist white man hugged the black man. And they heard about the drug users who used to be hooked on drugs for years, putting the drugs down, and instead of hallucinating because of the drugs, they're in their right frame of mind and they're receiving visions from God of their future to come, all because they got set on fire for God. People heard about the kids that were dancing in the Spirit, how people were in the, that were broken were being made whole, and how the man that was poor was now proclaiming that he was rich, how people who had cancer were being healed and set free. In 1995, God ignited America's firewall. No longer was his presence contained in one area, but news spread all across America and the world. And now in 2014, God wants to do it again. He wants to ignite our firewall so his Spirit can go forth and do his work. Habakkuk 3:2 in the NIV says, Lord, I have heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds. Lord, repeat them in our day. And in wrath, remember mercy. God, do your works again. Fill us with your fire. Young people, you have to get the fire of God, and then let him ignite every firewood wall that's been set up, every wall that you've placed, because you're too unashamed to let it go and let it out. Let me tell you, God is not looking for a lukewarm generation, and God is not looking for a quiet generation. He is not looking for a shy generation. This world is too radical to be quiet. God is looking for people that are willing to burn for him, that are willing to say, God, if you set me on fire, I'll go where you call me to go. I'll say what you tell me to say. I'll preach what you tell me to preach. I'll touch who you want me to touch. God is looking for a generation that he can set on fire to be used for his glory. But how do you get the fire? You got to get in his presence. God took me to the story of 1 Samuel chapter 3. And we read about Hannah. She conceived a child. She prayed for one, and God said, you're going to have one. So she got conceived a child, and she gave birth to it. And she told God, if you give me a child, I'll give it back to you. So when she birthed the child, Samuel, she gave it back to God. She dedicated it to God. And a few years later, Samuel stayed in the temple with Eli. He was the priest in the temple. And all his life, Samuel grew with Eli, and he did ministerial things alongside Eli. Anything Eli told him to do, Samuel was faithful to do it. I believe that as soon as he said, even if he said, give me a glass of water, I believe Samuel would have done it, because he was learning to be trained for God's work. But we read that Eli's eyes had grown dim, so it was hard for him to keep the light post burning, because he could not see it. So now it was Samuel's job. He had to keep watch of the light posts so that they didn't go out. And right here we see a transfer of jobs, not only in the physical realm, but in the spiritual realm as well. because it says that the word of the Lord was not relevant during Eli's time. But God, he started to raise up another that would be willing to listen to his voice. So now Samuel was in charge of lighting the lampposts. One generation is losing its vision, so it's up to the next generation to carry out the vision. Not only did Samuel had to keep watch of the light post, but it was also his job to make sure that the presence of God was safe. And I believe that when Samuel lit the light posts, that he was also in the same area of where the presence of God was. In order for him to be able to light the light post, he had to be in the presence of God. Just like in order for us to keep our fire burning, we have to stay in the presence of God. We cannot get away from it. We cannot stray from it, but we have to stay in the presence of God. In order for you to keep your fire burning, you have to stay right in the presence of God. God wants to set you so on fire for him so he can change you from the inside out so we can look more and more like him. 2 Corinthians 3:18, it says, "But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in mirror the glory of the Lord, and being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord." God wants to set us on fire for him so we can be purified. God cannot abide with sin. He has to clean out his temple first before he can live within them. But not only do we have to get ourselves in the presence of God to keep the fire burning, but we also have to die. The only way that God would accept an offering in the Old Testament is, one, it had to be perfect, but two, it had to be dead. And then and only then would God consume it by fire. You want to be on fire for God, you have to die first. You have to realize that when you said yes to Jesus, it has nothing to do with you anymore. You want to be on fire for God, you have to crucify your flesh. You want to be on fire for God, you have to say yes to God's will and no to your own. Because when you said yes to Jesus, nothing else about you even mattered anymore. Galatians 2:20 says, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I am no longer live, but Christ lives in me, that the life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." Not only do we have to get in God's presence, and not only do we have to die to ourselves, but we have to get in his word, and we have to pray and seek his face. David said in Psalms 119:11, "Your word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against you." In Psalms 163:1 says, "O God, thou art my God, earnestly will I seek thee. My soul thirsts for thee." We want God to set a fire in us. We want to burn for him. But there are times when God is trying to burn a fire, but we start to quench it because all of a sudden, instead of spreading the gospel, we start spreading the gossip, and we think that we're edifying the body when really we are quenching the body and killing it. And the Bible says that out of your belly flows rivers of living water. But sometimes when we start to speak the gossip, we pollute the water. And when people start to drink it, then they become contaminated, and then the branches of the Lord begin to die because all of a sudden we've mixed opinion with the gospel, and no longer is the gospel effective because we rather talk about people instead of talking about God, and we rather point fingers at one another instead of lifting hands to God and saying, "God, it's all you," and we rather try to defend ourselves when God is saying, "Why don't you just shut up and let me take care of you?" We think we have to defend ourselves when God says, "Be quiet, be still. This is not your battle to fight, but it's mine." We'd rather talk about it than pray about it. We'd rather talk about it and look at people's faces instead of looking at the face of Jesus. We want to be on fire for God, but we aren't willing to humble ourselves and be quiet when he's telling us, "Shut your mouth and seek my face and then will you hear from me. Then will you see me. Then will you behold my glory. And after we've been set on fire, and after our firewalls are burnt down, it's time that we help burn other firewalls down around the world. You say, Aubrey, how do I do that? We're raising money for Africa. You say, Aubrey, how can I do that? I can't go to Africa. And you know what? Maybe you can. I can't. There's no way I can go to Africa. In my mind, I can go to Africa. But physically, there is no way that I can go to Africa, at least right now. Well, speaking in faith. But you can give. You can give what God gives you, you know, financially. You said, Aubrey, I don't have the money to give to Africa. That's okay. You do have time. And you can give your time by praying and seeking the Lord's face, for praying for people in Africa, for fasting for them, for searching, looking for the Lord to do a work in Africa. Jesus told his disciples in Mark 16:15, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. The message of Jesus has got to be spread, and they need to hear around the world that Jesus can save, heal, deliver, set free, loose, purify, sanctify, redeem, and make new. And it can be done by you. Maybe you can't give, but you can give your time. And you know, it's not only Africa that needs to have firewalls ignited, but we have people in our backyards that are dying and going to hell. And it's our responsibility to be the mouthpiece of God. You say, Aubrey, how can I do that? You can share your testimony. Anytime I get a chance to tell my testimony, I get so excited because I know that God will do great things, that a seed has been planted and it can grow. The Bible says that we are overcomers by the word and of our testimony. And maybe you can help people around you, but also you can be set free as well by you speaking your testimony. Some people, a lot of you know me here, a lot of you don't. I'm going to sum mine up really quick. I was born with heart disease. The doctor said that I would not make it. I would not live. I was literally born with half a heart. The other heart, side of the heart was not there. So they told my parents, we don't know what to do, but we'll try everything we can. They flew doctors in from California. They still didn't know what to do. So they said, we're just going to do it, but don't expect to leave with two babies. I have a twin. She's sitting over there. She's perfectly healthy. So they said, we'll just do what we can. And surgery after surgery, they said, you're not going. Don't expect to leave with two babies. You'll only leave with one. Surgery after surgery, I had 6 open heart surgeries. During one surgery, I had a stroke and lost peripheral vision on both sides of my eyes on the left side. So I can't see you here. And if for some reason you're really skinny, I can't see you here. And sometimes at church, I feel really bad because people come up and they want to shake my hand, but they're on this side, so their hands out, and I'm just minding my business. And they're like, hey, I'm trying to shake your hand. I'm like, I am so sorry. I can't see you. If you could just come this way, that'd be great. I could shake your hand. And I feel like I'm like going to offend people sometimes. I can't help it. But surgery after surgery, I had a stroke, and I was going for a checkup one day. I was put on a heart transplant list because my heart was just, it was bad. It was really bad. I was put on a heart transplant list, and we went for a checkup one day. I think I was 1. I don't remember this. That would be awesome if I did. But my parents tell me about it. And my mom says that the doctor came in, and they started looking at everything going on, and he didn't say anything. He just went out and grabbed another doctor. And so he started looking, and then he left, and another doctor came in, and now there's 3 doctors, and then all of a sudden the whole room is filled with doctors. And my mom was like, you need to tell me what's going on, because my mom knew that when doctor after doctor kept coming in, something was wrong. Let me backtrack real fast. My mom said that while they took me into surgeries, a lady came. She was a nurse. My mom never seen her in the hospital, and she only saw her this one night. But my mom said that the lady walked up to the foot of her bed, grabbed her feet, and said, "The Lord." Mind you, my parents were not Christians then. They got saved way later. But the lady came up and grabbed my mom's feet, and she said, "The Lord gave you two babies, and you'll leave with two babies. Now go to sleep." So my mom, she went to sleep. Some years later, some doctors are coming in, doctors after doctors, and my mom's like, "You need to tell me what's going on, because the more doctors come in, the more nervous I'm getting, and you need to set this straight because I'm freaking out." So the doctor looked at my mom and she said, "Miss Roach, we don't know how this happened, but your daughter just received the other side of her heart that was missing. We don't know how this happened, but it's there, and your daughter's heart is whole. It's enlarged, but we're just not quite sure, but it's there, and we can't explain it." See, there's always a "but God." But God, even when we aren't faithful to Him, He is faithful with us. Even when we're not even serving Him, God is still planning out your life. And I find it funny that God had mine planned way before I was even born. He knew what I would go through. He knew the struggles that I would face. He knew the situations that I would be dealt with. And there would be days when I was little, I would dance. Me and my sister, we would dress up in our tutus and we would dance ballerina for my grandparents, because we thought that we were really good and we knew how. So we would dance, we would get dressed up, and I think, and I look back now, and I think that God was saying, "If you only knew." You know, I didn't know. I came to know the Lord when I was 13 years old. When I was little, I had no concept of God, no thoughts about Him. I really wasn't even concerned about it, really. But I believe that when I danced as an innocent little child, God looked down and He said, "Oh, if you only knew. If you only knew where I would take you. If you only knew what I was going to do in your life." And that's what He's saying to some of you tonight, if you only knew. Maybe some of you are walking around and you don't see purpose in your life anywhere. God is saying, "Baby, if you only knew the plans that I have for you." He's called each and every one of us. We have things to fulfill, things to do. We have firewalls that need to be ignited, and we can't do it unless we allow God to grab hold of our hearts and start to move in us. God is calling each and every one of us to do something, to make a difference, to be the hands and feet of Christ. And God's word needs to be preached. It needs to be set out. So tonight, let's not only ignite our firewalls, but let us ignite the world's as well. God is looking for people that said, "God, I had enough with playing church. I'm tired of going through the motions. I'm tired of pretending like I'm cool and I'm good. And I'm tired of feeling like I can't do this anymore." God says, "It's time for me to ignite your firewall." He's calling for a generation that is willing to go all out. You go all out or you go home. God is looking for a generation that would be earnestly to seek His face, that would give everything for the cause of Christ. I'm closing now. This is pretty short. I'm sure people are proud of me tonight because it's awfully short. But I am closing. But I do want to pray with people, because I know that there are some people here tonight that struggle with things about being set on fire for God, and maybe you're ashamed, or maybe you want to be like Jeremiah where you can't contain it, or maybe you want to be God like the disciples where they went out all around the world to declare the glory of God. That's what God is looking for. He's looking for a generation that wants to be used by Him. He's looking for people that would hunger and thirst after righteousness. He's looking for a generation that would preach His word boldly without compromise or hesitation, and that you don't care what happens to you, because you know greater is He that is in you than greater than He that is in the world. Nothing that comes against you can stop you, because if you got Jesus, baby, you got it all. If you got Jesus, I said, you got it all. Nothing can stop you. Nothing can hinder you. Nothing can prevent you. He's calling you, and He's calling you out. He's calling you, and He's calling you out. So maybe there's people here tonight that have struggled and have dealt with things that said, you know what, I want my firewall to be lit. No longer do I want to play church. No longer do I want to contain this, but I want to reach out. I want to branch out. I want to be set on fire for Him. If we could all stand. I don't know about you, but I just want to burn for God. I don't want anything to be in the way of me burning for Him. I want to be the hands and feet of Christ. I want to be able to touch the broken. I want to be able to minister to the hurting. I want to be able to preach His word to all around the world, because people need to know that Jesus is coming. And it breaks my heart to know that second after second there are people going to hell when we could have done something. And God is calling us to ignite the firewall. It's time for us to ignite the firewall. No longer can we keep this fire burning just within us. We have to let it go to the world, to our generations, to our communities, to our churches, to the workplaces. Because people are looking for the answer. When we have people coming in off the streets, it's because they're hungry for something. They don't want to, if they wanted to go to the club, they would have went to the club, but they came to the church because they need to be healed of things. So tonight it's time that we ignite the firewall. It's time that we ignite the firewall. It's time that we ignite the firewall so the glory of God can be spread. So with every head bowed and every heart open, maybe there's somebody here that's struggling, you know, with some things, you know, that you're not willing, you know, you're uncomfortable. You're uncomfortable with igniting the firewall. It's uncomfortable being exposed. I know it. I've been there. I have to be stripped of everything in order to be set free. And you know what? It's hard. It's very difficult and it's painful. But it's worth it. I'm telling you now, it's worth it. So maybe there are some people here that are saying, you know what? It's time that I ignite my firewall. It's time that I burn every wall down. It's time that I just let go of everything. No longer is it about me, but it's all about Jesus. It's time to ignite the firewall. If there's anybody here that wants to ignite their firewalls, lift your hands, raise your hands. It's time to ignite the firewall. If there's anybody here that wants to ignite the firewall, lift your hands high. Don't be ashamed. Don't be afraid. There's greater things.